Psalm chapter 90. And you're also going to turn to Psalm 92. Don't have that too far away. All right, so last week, Christmas, our Christmas Eve service, last Sunday night, it was a pleasure, it was a joy to have Nate and Caesar and Aaron come down, lead us in some Christmas stuff, and I really enjoyed at the end, candles all around, and everyone just really singing Silent Night, and it was awesome. It was awesome. Some people responded, you know, to the Lord, prompting their hearts. It was really good. One of the things that we talked about during the message there was that we talked about the path of peace. Everybody say the path of peace. The path of peace. And what we did is we specifically just looked at what peace even means to begin with. Because a lot of times when you think peace and I think peace, we just think there's no more problems or issues. I have peace in my life when there's absence of conflict and difficulty. Sometimes people think that. The Bible describes peace with two words in Greek and in Hebrew. Shalom, or say shalom. And everybody say eirne. That's in Greek. So shalom and eirne. And basically what that means is, that means that peace is not just the absence of problems, it's the presence of restoration and building towards further restoration. So that's why on Christmas, when the Prince of Peace comes, the Prince of Shalom, peace didn't come to the entire world. When Jesus came in a manger, the whole world wasn't peaceful, and it wasn't just like not having any more problems. There was chaos and oppression and difficulty all over the planet. But the reason why it's a big deal is because the Prince of Shalom came, and the Prince of Peace, that was God's effort towards rebuilding restoration back to the Father because it was lost. Sin had stolen my relationship, your relationship with God. It stole it. You could never have relationship with God. You could never go to heaven. You could never have your sins. I could never have my sins paid for. Until heaven made the first move. Because, by the way, we were lost in it. We could never, like, repay it. We could never get out of it. There wasn't some bank somewhere or some person where we could just pay money to or somehow hire to get us out of our sick condition. Heaven had to make the first move. Which, by the way, heaven didn't do anything wrong. But love prompted, and it said, oh my goodness, they are so lost and so far, they can never come close and be who they were called to be and be who they're destined to be without sin staining them and cursing them forever. We got to go save them. So the Prince of Shalom came, and we talked last week about the path of peace, because it starts with the Prince of Peace. It starts with him in a manger, the Prince of Shalom. But just because he was born in a manger doesn't mean people actually accepted him. It doesn't mean that at all. I need to walk around today. I just feel like I should be walking around more today. That I think will be helpful, because people like to nod off and like do stuff. Yeah, it'll be helpful. So it starts with the Prince of Peace, right? Shalom starts with that. But just because he's in a manger doesn't actually mean anything. It just means, wow, he made that initial first move. But it doesn't mean that humanity made any kind of any move at all towards him and received him. And we could like believe that it happened, but it doesn't at all mean that our souls are actually tied to that Prince of Peace. It doesn't mean that at all. So there's this path of peace. And the only people that actually get on the path of peace are the ones that say, you know what? That baby in the manger, God incarnate, yes, I believe that he was my savior, that he's a king, Lord of lords. He actually helped create me and create the world. I believe in him. I submit my life to him. Now you've just started on the path of peace. And then we walk on this path, which like we talked about last week. Listen, this is a confusing path. It's a humbling path. It's a challenging path. But amen, it's a victorious path. It's a victorious path. And the reason why is because our end destination is we're supposed to be and called to be. He wants to build up a people of peace. The Spirit of God resides in those that have said yes to Jesus. And the Spirit of God is working in my life, and He's working in your life. If you said yes to Jesus, He's working in your life. And what He's doing is He's building you up and building me up to be a person where I'm not enchained and enslaved by my circumstances. It doesn't mean they won't affect me. It doesn't mean I won't get upset. It doesn't mean I might not cry or be frustrated. But it does mean they won't keep me down and keep me out. And so we're called to become, and He's making us to become people of peace. And so we talked about that stuff last time. And so this Sunday, what we're going to talk about today is the path. No, not the path. The pace. There you go. Like, two people are paying attention. That's pretty good. Even if I'm walking around, I get two people. The pace of peace. The pace of peace. Because just because we're on some path, like, listen, if you go for a hike with people, I remember we did like the, where's he at? Remember we did that hike, man, going up that mountain? That was his first hike, man. And first of all, he was dressed like this. He was dressed nice. And there's nothing wrong with that. But it wasn't exactly hiking like gear. No, not like that anyways. That was Mr. Rick, and if you're Rick Porter, you know, he's just, and he had plans for not just some sort of like hike, like a 7 mile up the cliffs, look over, you could die kind of hike. What the heck, Rick? Like, oh, it'll be fine for, I said, are you sure, Rick? Is it going to be fine? Yeah, oh, yeah, it'll be fine for everyone. I said, not everyone, you know, hikes, and I don't, no, this is one of the easy ones. Rick, I trusted you. The idea being is that there's a pace, right? There's a pace. Just because you're on some path doesn't mean you're actually even moving at the pace that you should be moving on. And so I want to talk about that. And honestly, it's a super simple message today. It's a message about God's love, His faithfulness, that He never leaves us, He never forsakes us. And the crazy thing is that when Mark prayed this morning to start church, I didn't talk to them at all about any of this. But the entire focus of the message is trying to maintain our pace, and the best pace for a Christian to maintain is the one where God is moving. And honestly, one day at a time is an amazing pace to keep. You get too far in tomorrow, you're getting lost in the weeds. You're too stuck in yesterday, you haven't moved anywhere. And so the idea of just staying, just handling today, 2020, I have no idea what's going to happen. No idea. Now we're at the end of 2019. There's a lot of interesting things that happen. For us as a church family, you know, I think about a lot of different things as I think about 2019. I think about my own life personally. And I really recommend that you do this, by the way. Most of us, we can just remember all the problems, issues, dilemmas, and difficulties. But it actually takes quite a bit of hard work to sit down and just really think about, hey, where was the presence of God in my life in 2019? And that's going to go further than not where were things easier in my life in 2019. What are the things that I really liked? Not that those don't have any value, but I'm just saying when God works in our lives, it's not always in ways that we like or in the ways that we loved. So to sit down and actually write down, take a few minutes, and look at your calendar from 2019. Because that's what helps me, actually. I can easily remember when I look at a calendar. Like in January. What the heck was going on in January 2019? I don't know off the top of my head. So I have to look. I have to sit down. I have to look at the calendar. And say, Lord, like, I'm doing this on purpose because I'm trying to remember where you were at, because I just forget so easily. Tremendous, tremendous value in that. And go through January, February, March, April, May. Some will be easier. Some will be like, oh, yeah. That is what happened. What it also does is it guards you against just remembering the tough times. I can remember so many times in 2019 where people have said things to my face and they totally just lied to me. That never feels good. I mean, people say things said to my face and they say something totally something else to somebody else behind my back. Probably happened to you too. I can remember being in situations that it's like, what the heck is this? I didn't even bring this one upon myself. It just landed in my lap. All kinds of different situations. And so going back and remembering, though, that helps put my focus back on what's really important. Not necessarily all the problems, but definitely His presence. And so what we did for 2019, at least for us as a church family, I got a short video clip. Eric, you want to play that video clip? So just with some memories from 2019, okay? Okay.
see places to go and work to be done. This can't be over yet. No way. It just can't be.
Fun to watch that, right? It's fun to watch that. It makes me think about a lot of stuff throughout the past year. You know, we've done a lot of things. And I also wrote down some stuff too, because it's, again, I got to guard myself and I got to think about, you know, what the Lord has done with us. So some highlights that I wrote down here as far as for us as a church family during 2019 is, let's see here, so, where's Dawn? Dawn over there. Dawn, how many days now? 66 days of sober. Here we go, baby. And most people don't know is that, you know, she struggled with this stuff for a long time. A lot of it was kept in the dark and very secret for a while. And on a very random but divinely appointed Wednesday night prayer meeting, Dawn was not acting herself, acting very strange. And then as we're praying, she's writing down like crazy in this little book that she has. She's just writing, writing, writing. And I'm like, I'm actually kind of getting annoyed. I'm like, how the heck is she writing during all this like praying, you know? Like, this is basically, she might as well be on her phone the whole time. Like, what is she doing? And so, like, whatever, you know. So that happens. And then she leaves. She goes to the restroom. She goes down the hallway. And we keep praying. And then we sort of stop and we're just talking about whatever we're talking about. And then I just hear like this noise on the door down the hallway. And I'm like, what is that noise? I hear this noise, like a scratching at the door. I'm like, it's so weird. So we're trying to like ignore it. I don't know why, but we're ignoring it. But then it keeps going. So I'm like, I'm just going to go check on her real quick. And so I go look and she's on the floor in the bathroom. And not looking good. So Eileen was at prayer meeting, thank God. And it was another female prayer meeting, thank God. I said, hey, I said, you gotta, I'm not supposed to be in the bathroom with her on the floor, you know, like you need to come in here. And she's not talking right, she's talking crazy, like not right. Like just weird, weird stuff coming out of her mouth. And I was like, man, what is the deal? So we bring her back in, talk to her a little bit. She's still not sounding right. She's talking about just, you know, how worthless she is. She can't do anything, you know. And that stuff that she was writing, it was basically like a one-page letter, page and a half of just hate. Crazy stuff on there. Stuff like, you're not worth anything. You don't matter. Why do you bother trying? Just all this stuff, just scribbled out. And I'm not kidding you not, when we were praying, she just went. She never took a break. It was unnatural. So then we bring her in the prayer meeting, talk to her a little bit, lay hands on her, pray for her. She still kind of seems the same. She's not even really engaged during the prayer time. So I'm like, well, we're going to pray for her again. So we lay hands on her again. And then during that time, I could just sense and feel just like a sort of just release, just sort of like come. And it was just different. It was just different. That's all I can say. And after that, we're like, well, how do you feel? She's like, well, I don't know. I feel really out of it. I feel like really kind of all over the place. You know, and then I followed her home, and it's really weird. Then I followed with her afterwards, continuing, you know, to see how she's doing and updating. She stopped drinking that next day. She came to prayer meeting that night. So that was the other reason why I didn't really know what was going on with her, because she came to the prayer meeting, but she came, you know, half drunk. And that's not uncommon for people to come to church and come to events, because sometimes that's the only way they can deal with people. And sometimes that's the only way people can deal with holidays, is they're half in the bag. And it's just, and sort of better than not showing up, but at least, but when you're there, like, you're half not doing good and under the influence. And so I thought that was mainly what was driving that stuff on that Wednesday night. But come to find out, she had a significant deliverance from the Lord on that night. And she has never, I kid you not, she has not been the same. I don't know if you've talked with her. Dawn exactly doesn't like the spotlight and talk to a lot of people. But she has not been the same since. She has not been the same since. And I know Lori and Eileen have been coming alongside her and really helping her out. And not because they have degrees in addiction counseling, but because they said, hey, listen, there's an opportunity to minister to a sister. I'll just offer what I can and be available. And she's doing great. It's a big deal. It's a big deal. And that story's not over. It's not over. It's not over. I think about Eileen praying over service maybe like a month or 2 months ago, and I think we're in the hallway and I volunteered her to pray for a church service. And she's like, no, you know, just I don't know about that, Jared. I don't know. I said, okay, well, I'll just stand next to you and we'll just see what happens. So I just stood next to her, but then she prayed over service. And it's like during the worship time, the place just erupted. It was amazing. It was amazing. It was just like, I don't know. She just had to just pray over service that morning to just release freedom in this place. It was great. It was awesome. Like, that's celebratory to me. A few weeks ago, Kyle, he texted me and he goes, hey, Jared, would you mind if I feel like God put on my heart to provide some space at the beginning of service and use the whole service as a time and opportunity to give people the chance to write down what they've been holding on to that maybe they shouldn't be holding on to, or something they're really battling with, and just leave it at the altar during church as an act of agreement that they shouldn't be holding on to it, or they need to let go, and then a sign of surrender when they leave it at the altar. I said, okay, sure, sounds good. I didn't know who was going to do it. I thought maybe two people, you know, I don't know. The whole service. So there was like 40-something cards up there. And we prayed about that stuff on that following Wednesday night. And I still personally continue to. That was extremely courageous for people that did that. And it doesn't, for some of those things, it might be over now, the battle. It might be. But for a lot of those things, that battle might very much still be on. But at least now they're fighting from the proper place. And God used Kyle in that moment to do that. I celebrate that stuff. That's stuff I'm excited about. I'm happy about. I'm happy about our worship team growing and doing better. You guys also don't know that for the longest time, I desire to and I continue to hope for more songs of worship that have not been recorded by other people, but they have just come out of private, intimate times with the Lord, and we get to sing them together as a church family. That's the type of worship I look forward to. That's what I'm most excited about. Jesus culture and elevation and, you know, and all these. Sure, they got awesome stuff. It's great. Hillsong, God has blessed them and has anointed them. But I really love, my heart has a special place for songs, new songs of worship that are birthed out of intimate times with the Lord. What an amazing sign of health. You can't judge the health of a worship team by how well they can play a song. You judge the health of a worship team by their intimacy with the Lord. And that's evidenced by songs just coming out of them. And so we had our first song come out not too long ago. We'll be able to sing it sometime soon. But that's amazing. That's exciting. I'm like, thank you, Lord. Like, that's good. It's really healthy and good. You'll know about that. You'll know more about that later. I'm excited to hear kids learning Bible verses. I'm excited about baptisms, dedications. Carol and her mom, or Becky and her mom Carol, they're going to join up pretty soon. We're going to baptize them, and we're going to welcome them as members soon. Like, this is awesome. And not to put them on the spot too much, but just a little bit, like, the Lord has just been blowing through their family in a ridiculous way. A very profound and significant way. And so I say that to say, thank you, Lord, that's awesome. But I also say that because I'm speaking to other members of the family. I'm saying, keep them in prayer. Because the enemy would love to just stop that in its tracks. Also, another Wednesday night. For those of you that don't know, my wife does not come to too many prayer meetings. It's like, since we planted the church, I mean, I could probably, you know, count on one hand how many times she's come to Wednesday nights. And that's because, like, we have kids and we have a schedule. And it's just typically if someone's going to go, I'm typically going to be the one going. And it's not because I don't ask her. It just works out that way. But she came maybe a month and a half ago. And she came crying. And that just personally for me was just a massive highlight. Because it was just a situation that she just knew. She wasn't supposed to just handle it on her own and just deal with it and suck it up buttercup. She knew that this was above her fleshly pay grade and it needed to be put in the right spot. And I'm thankful that people were there to also see that. That was powerful. That's a courageous moment. And that was pretty awesome. The Gass family, been through a lot. That's one of those families where I think about and I almost want to cry because they have been through a lot. You always see their kids. You always see them. They're in the back row, whatever. But you always see them. They're always here. You know where their heart lies. That's not a small thing. It's not a small thing. There's plenty of people that when life gets like that, and listen, it's happened. It's happened in 2019. There's plenty of people that it's just life got the best of them. And they're not in a great place right now. I have personally been a part of and hearing courageous confessions from people. I've heard of people in this church having courageous conversations. I've heard of people and been around people that have taken courageous challenges. It's all a sign of good stuff. And so I think of 2019, and I think at least of us as a church family, that's some of the stuff that comes to mind. I don't know what comes to mind for you. I don't know what comes to mind for your life. But it's definitely worth the time and worth the energy to just sit down with the Lord and just say, Holy Spirit, what have I forgotten that I need to remember? What maybe has like, just, what have I forgotten? Or what have I missed? Or what have I just not, you know, in Hebrews 3:15 it says, do not harden your hearts when you hear his voice. What things have you been hard to? So you're probably like, well, is he ever going to read this passage? I am right now. Psalm 90 verse 12 says this. It says, teach us to number our days aright, that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Moses wrote this psalm. It says, teach us to number our days aright, that we may gain a heart of wisdom. You know, one of the best things that we can do, what does that mean? Teach us to number our days aright. Well, here's what that means. It means when we number our days, that means basically we're just humble about it. That basically means that my life is not guaranteed. If I take like a, if I take a spray bottle and I spray it right now in the air, you'll see like the mist for a minute and then it's gone. And that's the way the Bible describes my life and your life. That's it. That's all we get. And eternity is just forever. So we got this little blip here. And so Moses, you know, he's saying, he's like, Lord, help me just to like humbly just number my days the right way. I only got a limited amount of time here. Help me to handle that with wisdom so I can be wise about like the limited time that I do have. And one of the mistakes that we can make 2019 going into 2020 is be like, I'm going to do that Bible plan and I'm going to do this and I'm going to do that and I'm going to have these goals. Like, just handle today. Just handle today. Make the rest of this Sunday exactly what it's supposed to be, pleasing before the Lord. It makes you treat things differently. People will come into church and they will choose to sing songs. They will choose to like engage. They will choose to raise their hands. They'll choose to read along. They'll choose to take what happens here and bring it back to their family and talk more about it later. Not like, hey, what did you think about it? But hey, what did the Spirit stir up? What did he speak to your heart like during that time that we were together this morning? Like, make today legit. An offering that you would just be proud of. That's where we got to be. That's where we got to live. That's the most important thing, because you can only handle today. If you're thinking about tomorrow and all the possible stuff that can happen there, or all the drama that awaits you in 2020, you'll be so defeated and so overwhelmed, you're going to quit before you start. And if you're so bogged down by all your mistakes of 2019, and you're so conscious of all that, that's going to rob you from just enjoying right now. And so Moses is saying, hey, Lord, teach me, because I don't know how to do that. I don't know how to handle one day at a time. What I do know how to do is, I do know how to worry and think ahead, because that's the way we frame it. Oh, I'm being wise, I'm thinking ahead. You're so wise, aren't you? Yeah, and full of anxiety and fear. He's like, Lord, teach me, I don't know how to do that. Show it to me, teach it to me, I don't know. Show me what season I'm in right now and how to handle that responsibly and like use it before you. It's a really wise psalm. And I think that what that does for us is that, right, it says that so that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Because if we're able to do that, then we'll be able to walk wisely through life. And I think that's what we're after. We're not trying to be smarter, we're trying to be wiser. That's what we want to do. Be able to discern what's good from what's best. So let me tell you something about the pace of peace, the pace of peace. Say it with me so I remember. The pace of peace. Yes, I need to remember. I know. It's my message. I need to remember. The pace of peace, the pace of peace. The pace of peace is one day at a time. So I can handle. AA was on to something. I looked up, you know, where that phrase came from. I know where it started, who started it. The reality is nobody knows. There's actually some amazingly good stuff, you know, in AA and the 12 steps and what's in their book, and a lot of it Christian-based, but a lot of it, as you read and you look through their documentation and the stuff that they have, they don't know where half their stuff came from. But it started somewhere with someone having some intuition to do something, and they just started doing it, and then it caught. And that phrase is one of them. One day at a time. With the reality being, like, listen, you can only handle so much. And just focusing on just one day. Just handle the one day. That's it. Focus on that. That's the pace we want to work with. To where we're primarily in this point today. Because someone might say, well, okay, well, listen, I'll focus on today, but how can I have a vision about tomorrow and just focus on today? I'd say it's a good question. Some of us have different places. Some of us have different places, like where you can maybe think a little bit more about the future and it won't overwhelm you. For some people, you can't think a lot about the future. It won't be healthy or good for you. Just like for some people, they can't go into a bar. They just can't. Some people, they could. They're going to be okay. For some people, they can't have that drink. But some people, they can. For some people, they can't eat that food. But for some people, they can. Right? You got to be really wise with this stuff. And really discern it. And that's why I'm always saying, Father, teach me, because I don't know. I don't know. And I want my heart to be filled with wisdom, not with intelligence. Not that intelligence is bad. I'm not saying, hey, let's be stupid. I'm not saying that. I'm saying let's be wise, be able to discern what's best. So what's the pace of peace look like? One day at a time? Here's what we could do in some days. Look at Psalm 92. I'm not going to spend a lot of time here because we're going to finish up. Psalm 92 gives us some really good insight for the pace of one day, what that might look like. The pace of one day. Look at this, verse 1. Psalm 92. It is good to praise the Lord and make music to your name, O Most High. To proclaim your love in the morning and your faithfulness at night. It's a pretty good way to handle a day, by the way. And the emphasis here is proclaim. Some versions say declare. Again, in verse 15, it's going to say declare or proclaim. The point of emphasis in this psalm is that this is an individual who will verbally, out loud, not just in their heart, pray it. I'm not against prayers in your heart. It's not a bad thing. The Bible's not against it. But I'm saying public verbal prayers and declarations and proclamations are sweeter. And they're important. It's important for a man and woman of God. In the morning, at night, you pick your two times a day. In this particular psalm, they're saying the morning and at night. They're verbally saying, God, you are good and you are faithful. I'm choosing to praise you and position myself or my family, right, if they have a family. We're choosing to position ourselves under your leadership. We're excited about where you're going to bring us. Doing that. It's just a lifestyle thing. You see that two times here. And not only are they doing it, they're making music about it in their home. I love that. Absolutely love it. And some of us, we suck at music. So then we say, thank God for iMusic and Amazon Music. And YouTube. There we go. They can handle the music. We'll handle the vocals. And we're feeling brave, we'll turn them down and really get our worship on. But if you're good at music, man, let that fill your home. Let it fill your home. So it's good to praise the Lord. Make music to your name, O Most High, to proclaim your love in the morning and your faithfulness at night, to the music of the 10-string lyre and the melody of the harp. Why would somebody be singing? Verse 4. For you make me glad by your deeds, O Lord. I sing for joy at the works of your hands. How great are your works, O Lord. How profound are your thoughts. And so you just don't sing because you like music. The response of singing and proclaiming is because we've sat down to take some time and think about, what does it say? His works, his deeds. We've sat down to think about his works and his deeds. How stuff plays out when he's in charge. When you do that, and when I do that, it causes us to then just respond in song and in singing and in thanksgiving. When it's difficult for us to find things that we're thankful for, it's a really clear indication that we're really not really close to His heart at that period in time. But when we're close to His heart, and we make time to consider His ways and the way that He works, even if it's not a great situation, we are able to rise up in praise. And that's where all the praise is coming from. It's when somebody sits down to consider and think about who God is. And some people are like, well, I don't want to read my Bible. It's too boring. It's too much. I don't want to go to church. I don't want to go to that group. Well, listen, every time you make a choice, every time I make a choice to disconnect myself from places and people of God, I'm making it more difficult for myself to ponder and think about what He's like and what He's doing. That's why gathering together as a church family and being a part of things of His church family is so critically important. So check this out. Verse 6 says, "The senseless man does not know, fools do not understand, that though the wicked spring up like grass, and all evildoers flourish, they will be forever destroyed." Whoa, whoa, whoa. That just got violent real quick. I'm going to say something on that. Verse 8, "But you, O Lord, are exalted forever. For surely your enemies, O Lord, surely your enemies will perish. All evildoers will be scattered." It's interesting what he does in this psalm here. He says, you know, "I think about your works, Lord, and what you're like, and it causes me to praise." And then it's interesting how he talks about the evildoers, those that are filled with sin. And when I think about this, I'm not really thinking people. I'm thinking the evil behind those people. And people that have either rejected the Lord, are in full-blown rebellion, or they just stiff on the Lord in everything. That would be an evildoer. Someone that's in full-blown rebellion, full-blown rejection, or they just stiff arm everything to the Lord. Like, God is around, but they just constantly make the choice, I just don't want it in and around my life. That would be an evildoer, as the Bible describes it. And so this person, it's interesting to me that this individual who wrote this psalm, which we don't know, I think it's Asaph, but this individual, he says, well, I don't understand it. It seems like they're never sick. They got the best jobs. They make the most money. They got the happiest families. And here I am trying to do the right thing, trying to keep myself clean, trying to keep myself on the right path, trying to be honest, trying to work on purity in my heart, and it seems like everything's a struggle and everything's a fight. And some people, they just stop right then and there, and they become very bitter, very salty, very confused, and then very paralyzed in relationship with the Lord. But because this individual in this psalm, he says he takes time to consider the Lord's works, consider His deeds, consider His ways, guess what? He has a wisdom that rises up about these evildoers that are far from the Lord. He says, well, listen, kind of is what it is. Eventually, they're going to stand before this same king, before the same throne, and they got a short life just like me. You know what? I don't have to police them. I'm not the judge. It's not my job to judge them. They're going to stand before the Lord, and they're going to have to give an account. And what's interesting to me is that when we think about the Christmas story, like, that was Christ's first arrival. Do you know that throughout the New Testament, I wrote this down here, His second arrival, there is, let me get it for you here, check this out. Of the 260 chapters in the New Testament, there are more than 300 references to the Lord's return. 260 chapters in the New Testament, over 300 references to the Lord's return. Crazy thing is, you don't like actually hear much preached about the Lord's second coming. One out of every 30 verses, that's about how often the second coming is talked about in the New Testament. 23 of the 27 New Testament books refer to this event. For every prophecy on the first coming of Christ, Christmas, there are 8 on Christ's second coming. That's the proportion. So it's 8 times as more likely to hear about the second coming than you are about the first coming. So when you read in this psalm, this person, this individual is carrying this sort of mentality in mind, says, hey, listen, like, this isn't forever anyways. And for us as believers and Christians, we got to carry that as well. Like, listen, this world's going to get worse. Our nation's going to get worse. Things are going to be increasingly become more anti-God. Marriage will continue to be redefined. We're going to continue to unnecessarily kill people. We're going to continue, right, to be in this environment. And so the answer is not like, oh my gosh, like we should keep panicking and feel more depressed every time it happens. We knew it was going to happen. That's why Jesus said, the love of most will grow cold. Hopefully, except for those that are close to the Lord's heart. And I don't think that means we just lay over when things get difficult and when they're hard. I don't think that just, oh, it's just going to happen, so I'm just not. No, we can still rise up and have a voice. We could still stand for truth. Let's be careful how we do it, but certainly let's do it. So he says, hey, you know what? They're going to stand before the judge. But check this out. I'm going to skip down to verse 12. The righteous will flourish like a palm tree. They will grow like a cedar of Lebanon. Planted in the house of the Lord, they will flourish in the courts of our God. They will still bear fruit in old age. They will stay fresh and green. When you think of old age Christians, do you think fresh and green? Proclaiming, the Lord is upright, he is my rock, and there is no wickedness in him. Right, I love the imagery and the picture we get of those that choose to stay on this pace. This kind of pace, where they take advantage of one day, morning and night. They choose to stay close and consider the Lord's works and his ways. And those days, they add up to weeks, they add up to months, they add up to years. Before you know it, they're getting older, but they're hanging out, they're firmly planted in the people and in the place of God, and they're still fresh, they're still green, they're still happy about who the Lord is, they're still declaring and decreeing and proclaiming that he is good and he is faithful. And when I think about one of the things that grieves my heart over the past 2019 is I think about people that little by little they let their hearts become a little more calloused each day. And I think about where some of those people are at now and say, man, you know what? The strategy was never just to just get them all out of it right away. It was very slowly. Just eat away at it. Just very slowly get them to just get away from the people of God. Get them to get away the presence of God. Just very slowly. Not think it's that important to really hang out with the Lord. Maybe just attend church. Just do that. That's fine. Listen, church ain't going to fix this for you. This is a good place we get to come together and declare like good news and good works. And when we come together, like we can theoretically do more. But for our own personal growth and revelation of who God is and what he's like and to truly walk in triumph and in victory, it's the other days. That's really what it's about. And so my prayer for us before we take communion here, Hebrews 3:15, it says, today if you hear his voice, everybody say today. Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as you did in the rebellion. So let me pray, and we're going to take communion together. So Heavenly Father, I pray that myself and all of us, as we've heard your voice today, as we will hear your voice the rest of today, and sometimes, Lord, we don't know if it's your voice or not. And that's a real issue and problem too. But I pray, Heavenly Father, that we would be a people that if we think it's your voice, that we would just respond and just move on out. And if we're wrong, we're wrong. So I pray that we would be a people that if we sense your presence and your voice today, that we would respond today. And I just pray, Lord, for each person here that might have a difficult time with handling just today. We pray just for a breakthrough in their mind and in their hearts, a real peace, an ability to just focus. And I know by the power of your Spirit, you will make us able. You'll make us able to focus just on today and where you're moving and breathing and working today. And we look forward to being fresh and green and powerful and flourishing. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So let's pass out these elements. Brian, can you play that song for us as we're going to take this together? Thanks. There we go. Thanks.
To wait, she stands.